So, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. I welcome you all, and it's nice to see everyone is there. It gives me great pleasure on behalf of FINE and Dr. Sudhir Kothari to welcome Dr. Vasudevan. As you can see, he's a professor and head of department of Savita Medical College at Chennai. Dr. Vasudevan is a graduate from KEM Hospital, Mumbai, where he obtained his DM in neurology. And then he moved to Chennai. He has multiple publications to his name and some are like research articles. And besides general neurology, his interest has been in neuromuscular disorders and neurophysiology, which he himself is an expert at. He's been an examiner for DM exam, and he has had these unique workshops where we do perform, where he's hosted and conducted electrophysiology in walk-in patients for an audience at Savita Medical College. So we thought, who better than to help us in this pitfalls in understanding the EDX report. So let me welcome Dr. Vasudevan. Over to you, Vasu.
Thank you, Krishnama. Good afternoon, everybody. At the outset, let me thank the organizers of FINE. And let me thank Dr. Mansukhani for giving me this opportunity to join you today on this forum. And the topic that has been given to me is, I have been asked to speak on, is pitfalls in the in understanding the EDX report. Now, this is pitfalls. You will not find it as a chapter or a topic or a part of a textbook. It is something which is very nebulous and which is, it is a process. It is a dynamic process which begins from the referral to the actual performance of the test, the report, the interpretation, the writing of the report, and the way the report is finally read by the referring consultant himself. So, taking those things into account, I have tweaked the title, and now I would like to call it Pitfalls in EDX, Two Sides of the Coin. Now, they're both same, two sides of the same coin. Now it will be nice if we can appreciate what goes into the process and how we can try to overcome many of these very incipient and very very difficult to identify kind of pitfalls, which are very deceptive and leads to erroneous conclusions and therefore erroneous diagnosis and treatment for the patient. So let us start with what, the question is, the basic is, what are the goals of electrodiagnostic study? The two major goals of electrodiagnostic examination include lesion localization and lesion characterization. So these are the two main goals of why we do an electrophysiological test. We need to know where the lesion is and what the lesion is. Lesion should be localized to the peripheral nervous system and the structures involved, like it may be the neuron, the root, the plexus, nerve, neuromuscular junction, or where possible to specific element like C7 root or cord or ulnar nerve, etc. Now we should be able to localize to the particular nerve or whichever structure is involved to that level. And characterization means which we try to arrive at the pathological and the pathophysiological features which are underlying the process, the severity, the rate of progress, and all these things. This information is not only of diagnostic utility, but it also helps to a great extent in patient management, points the direction, and also gives a hint as to the prognosis in many of these patients. So these are the set goals of an EDX study. So what is then required when we start an EDX study? What is required? It is necessary to have a very clear clinical diagnosis at the outset. Now, this is very, very important. I never tire of mentioning this again and again, both in wherever I speak or wherever I, take classes for students. It is before you send a patient or you request an electrophysiological examination, you should have a proper clinical diagnosis in your mind, or at least a short list of a few differential diagnoses which you would like to go through or sift through, and at the end of which you should be able to arrive at least one particular diagnosis. The second most important thing that we should remember is that though electrophysiology is an extension of the clinical examination, again this is very, very important. Electrophysiology is never standalone. It is always an extension of the clinical examination, yet it should be independent and it should be objective in its reporting and as well as the process of studying. And therefore, it follows that a very thorough knowledge of the anatomy of the peripheral nervous system and the muscle neuromuscular junction as well as the physiology, both these are absolutely essential for a person to be able to perform and report an electrophysiological study. So then we come to the actual process of referral. Now this thing is a chain, you know, you can't separate them into compartments. This occurs as a continuous whole, a continuous, smooth, seamless process which occurs from in the beginning when the person sees a patient for diagnosis and then referring. So here we come across some interesting possibilities. You know, the thing is, a referring physician is well versed in anatomy and disorders of the nervous system as well as the electrodiagnostic examination. So most often such a person is a neurologist. So when a neurologist refers a person for an electrodiagnostic investigation, the situation becomes clearer, it becomes simpler, it becomes easier, because we expect that the patient comes to the electrophysiology lab with clear cut diagnosis or a differential diagnosis with very specific questions which are asked by the referring doctor. For example, he would want to know whether there is an underlying muscle disease, or whether it's specifically an acute muscle disease, or whether it is acute injury to the plexus or so on, and with specific localization, whether it is upper trunk or lower trunk or whatever. That's only an example. So that is one of the first possible scenario where the process becomes easier, clearer, both for the electrodiagnostician as well as for the patient. The second possibility is when the referring first physician is also the electrodiagnostician. Many of us neurologists have our own electrophysiology labs when they are working in the periphery. They have their own EMG machines. Many of them have technicians who work for them. They perform their own. They see the patient. They diagnose. They arrive at the conclusion and then they do the tests themselves. Now, in certain situations, this may be ideal, but here again, there are very deceptive pitfalls. You know, the thing is, when you are yourself diagnosing and then performing, you tend to have an inherent bias towards the diagnosis that you have already made, and therefore, the test which you perform may be suboptimal in the sense that you may choose to limit your test to perform those parts of the test which will point to the direction in which you have made a diagnosis. For example, if a person comes to you with numbness of his thumb and index finger, and you feel that this is cervical radiculopathy because the patient may have also had some neck pain, it is possible that one may not perform a detailed examination to rule out entrapment spore distally. So in such a situation, it is likely to be missed. Similarly, it is also possible that the clinical diagnosis can intrude into the final reporting. For example, a person who comes with pain in the thigh, weakness, absent knee jerk, and who is also severe diabetic with an HbA1c of say 8.4 or 9, can be, in the true electrodiagnostic sense, it is likely that he may have a denervation. It is possible that he may have a plexopathy or a radiculopathy. But if you already have access to some information that as a clinician, it is likely, very likely to color your electrodiagnostic process. So this should also not be, this should not be done. In fact, when you do an electrophysiological test, you should be more objective in choosing the tests, performing them, and then interpreting them separately, rather than being influenced by your clinical judgment. Of course, clinical judgment is necessary, but it should not dominate the process of performing the test. Therefore, as you can see, there are likely places for pitfalls to occur right from the beginning, the referring process, the performance, and then later on the interpretation. The third possibility is when the referring physician is not well versed in either neurology or the process of electrophysiology. For example, it may be a general physician, or for that matter, a physician or a pediatrician or an orthopedician. The patient may have had some form of trauma, and they refer the patient to you for an electrodiagnostic test. Here, the working diagnosis can very often be vague or very non-specific. For example, you might get referral saying, pain in the leg, please do EMG. So this is very very vague and non-specific. So in such situations, it is incumbent on the electrodiagnostic consultant to actually perform a focused, at least a limited neurological examination relevant to the problems with which the patient has come, and then proceed with the electrodiagnostic test. If that is not done, and going to the pressure of time, if exactly what is asked is done, then very likely the yield of the test is going to be erroneous. So these three scenarios contribute very certainly to the possibilities of development of pitfalls in the process. So let us come to what the referring doctor wants. What the referring doctor wants, depending on his or her level, is he may want a diagnosis, or when the person is a specialist, he may want confirmation of a diagnosis that he has, or in certain other situations, they may want ruling out of certain possibilities. Now we will discuss about this later when we are looking at pitfalls. Ruling out and ruling in, these are fraught with possible errors. So some people will say rule out ulnar neuropathy, or rule out Bell's palsy for that matter. So these are certain kinds of things that come to us when we do tests, and we have to be careful in how we look at the referral request. So in essence, when there are such referral requests which are vague or incomplete, it is necessary for the person doing it to take a history, do an examination, and then perform the test. So based on this, based on the above, the referring doctor also would probably be looking for a line of treatment and possible prognostication, for example, in say nerve injuries. What the electromyographer wants. Now the other side of the coin is what we want. We would be happy if there is a very specific clinical diagnosis. It makes the job easier. It makes the process more focused. It gives greater clarity. If not, at least a limited set of differentials are essential so that it can again help us to tailor the test to the particular patient. And specific queries regarding localization, characterization, or even prognostication can be expected. So now the next step is choosing the test. Now, how do we choose the test? The process of choosing the test or the appropriate test is entirely the responsibility of the clinical neurophysiologist and not the referring doctor. Now, this is very, very important to be emphasized, and for all people who plan to do electrophysiology, they should know this. For example, if a person has been sent by somebody else with a request for nerve conduction, lower limbs, if we just do the routine nerve conduction of the lower limbs and send him away, it may or may not serve the purpose at all. So when the patient comes to us, it is necessary for us to choose the test and then perform it. Now, even the performance of the test, it is not a static process. It is not as if we design a protocol and then apply the same protocol sort of mindlessly to everybody. Electrophysiology, as we do it, is not like ECG. ECG is the same for anybody and everybody who walks in. Whereas here, it is a very dynamic series of steps. It is real time. And even as the test is being performed, the electromyographer who is either supervising or actually doing it is integrating the entire flow of results in his mind and then deciding on the next step. For example, if a person comes with weakness in the small muscles of the hand, which is of a subacute duration, probably of after trauma, you do ulnar, you do upper limb studies, not enough, then you extend it, you do certain special studies, and then you extend it, you do EMG in the hand, and then you extend it to the forearm, and you go on, you are able to properly get a full picture and localize. So therefore, this process is really very much real time, and it progresses dynamically, even as the test is being performed. So this is very, very important to remember. So if there is a misstep, or if there is a wrong decision at any particular step, the test may progress in a wrong direction, and therefore wrong results may accrue. So what are the procedures? Now, you know, I am going to go through this in very brief, because even this can contribute to pitfalls in the performance and therefore the interpretation of the test. So patient counseling is very important. Many patients are very anxious when they come for the test, and therefore they need to be counseled. Many of them are afraid of the electrical shock or the needle, so they have to be reassured, and we need to tell them that this is not dangerous and every safety precaution has been taken for the well-being of the patient and so on. And most important is that we need to be familiar with the patient's findings before starting the test. And the nerve conduction or the RNS may be performed by a qualified technologist, but it should be under supervision. EMG should be performed by the EMG should always be performed by the electrodiagnostic consultant himself or herself, and it should not be performed by a technician, because this is, again, as I said, this is the most real time of all the processes, and this has to be assimilated thoroughly and incorporated into the findings and therefore the report. All nerve conduction findings must be produced before starting a nerve EMG, and additional nerve conductions may be added to complete the exam. For example, when you are doing upper limbs, the electrodiagnostician may find it appropriate to add, for example, medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm, or median sensory from the thumb and the middle finger, and so on, to be able to get more clarity in findings before proceeding with the EMG examination. And in further progress of the same thing, even when we do procedures in extremely anxious or uncooperative patients like children, needle EMG should focus on muscles which are most likely to give us a good yield, which are likely to be abnormal. Instead of poking them all over, select the muscles and then perform the ones which are likely to give the best yield, so that you can focus the procedure, probably minimize the discomfort of the patient, and yet get a good result. And in certain situations, protocols are valuable in approaching groups of disorders which have replicable findings. So these are useful when you know that the findings are replicable very reliably. So now we come to the actual sources of pitfall. Now these are the human process, you know, of diagnosis, of the referral process, who is referring, how they are referring, what is expected, and so on. Now when we come to the performance of the test, actual sources of pitfalls, there are physiological and non-physiological. Among the physiological ones, the most important are the temperature. This cannot be overemphasized. This is extremely important. You can't have an EMG lab which is having AC at full blast and going at say 18 or 19 degrees, which will obviously affect the findings in your test. Age, again, this is extremely important. With extremes of age, the normative data are different. Normal values are different, and this, the findings have to be interpreted in those light, in that light. Height of the patient is again very significant, especially when we are looking at proximal segment studies, which is length dependent. There are other length dependent processes as well, which will be affected by the height of the patient, obviously. Proximal versus distal segments, anomalous innervations and apparent courses should always be kept in mind when you find some abnormal findings when you are doing nerve conduction studies. Among the non-physiological ones, these are more technical. We won't go into all these details. These are more for the lab personnel themselves, like electrode impedance mismatch, 50 hertz artifacts. It's important to know this so that you are able to, the person who is doing the test, it is important for the person who is doing the test to know this, identify them, and then eliminate them while doing the test, so that you are free of artifacts and therefore pitfalls. Now, this is a very busy slide. We won't go into all the details here. This shows the technique, the pitfall, and the explanation for why it occurs and how it can be overcome. Now, for those who are interested, this is available in Malik's article in JNNP. It's a open access article, and you can access this. Or if you want these, I can send over the slide to you for you to go through it. So essentially, it outlines various procedures like motor nerve conductions, proximal studies like F-waves, sensory nerve conductions, RNS, what are the possible processes which can cause pitfalls, and the possible explanations for them and how to overcome. Now we come to actual pitfalls in interpretation. Now in the interpretation, once the test is finished, as I was saying, it is a dynamic process. Even while performing the test, the person who is doing the test has an idea in his or her mind as to in which direction the test is progressing, and therefore they come to a reasonable conclusion by the time they have reached the end of their examination. Again, here there are certain possibilities. One is overinterpretation. A limited numerical abnormality must be reported, but it should be placed in the context of the clinical problem. For example, the finding of a subclinical carpal tunnel abnormality and nerve conduction does not make the diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. This is very common, especially in women or patients in who have thyroid disorders. We may find subclinical abnormalities in median nerve conductions, and that does not automatically mean that the patient is suffering from a carpal tunnel syndrome. It should be identified, but the patient should not be labeled with a diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. A nerve conduction abnormality may relate to a previous injury, and it may be currently irrelevant, and therefore these things also should be borne in mind. So one should not be over enthusiastic and over interpret findings. It should be in the light of the current clinical context for which the patient has been referred. And oversimplification. Now again, this is another problem. You know, sometimes reports tend to be oversimplified, and certain findings which do not fit in with the examiner's construct or an idea tend to be brushed under the carpet. So this should not be done, and everything should be taken into account in a realistic manner, and therefore all studies should be interpreted together in case multiple diagnoses are present. In a patient with obvious polymyositis, nerve conduction should definitely be performed, so to see if there is any additional coexisting neuropathy. Misinterpretation. So if the fastest motor nerve conduction velocity is normal, for example, the patient may still have slowing of conduction of other nerve fibers related to a neuropathy. So just because motor nerve conduction velocities in some situations are normal doesn't mean that the patient does not have a problem. Similarly, if the snaps are normal in all respects, the patient may still have a small fiber sensory neuropathy, which produces symptoms and signs, and this has to be taken into account, and either the test has to be tailored accordingly or this has to be noted in the findings. If a nerve is reported unstimulatable, then you should automatically think of anomalous innervation or anatomical variations of nerve position before concluding that there is a pathology. So before saying that it is abnormal, we need to think of other possibilities which can be at the extremes of normal variations. And then the interpretation, misinterpretation of RNS results. Now if a decrement, for example, continues throughout the RNS train, this is probably an artifact. This is a useful tool. If a decrement is found in RNS, it is not always pathognomonic of myasthenia, because there are other conditions which can produce similar problems like motor neuron disease. So if you find slow stimulation RNS to show a decrement, it does not automatically mean that the patient has a diagnosis of myasthenia gravis. The patient should be examined thoroughly to rule out all the other possibilities. So the examination, both clinical prior to the EDX and the EDX itself, has to be quite comprehensive so that we do not go astray in the wrong direction. Again, while myasthenia and LEMS are the most common neuromuscular transmission disorders of the postsynaptic and the presynaptic types, one should not miss correctly diagnosing less frequent or less common disorders like congenital myasthenic syndromes, drugs or toxins like organophosphates, all of which have characteristic patterns when the tests are interpreted together with the clinical picture. Now, that is very, very important here. So no test, no single test should be interpreted or diagnosed in isolation. That is very, very important. Now for the referring doctor. If the referring doctor has not asked a specific question of the electrodiagnostic consultant, they should not be surprised if occasionally their request is misunderstood. So like, for example, like I said earlier, pain in the leg, please do EMG, or pain in the leg, please do nerve conduction. These tests are most likely to come through as normal, and it is totally unhelpful or even misleading for the referring doctor, and therefore one should not be surprised. If you don't ask specific questions, you are very, very unlikely to get specific answers. An EDX request should never be couched in "please exclude" terms. While probabilities may be discussed, total exclusion of a diagnosis depends on non-biological errors, especially sampling errors. Because of statistical peculiarities and standard deviations, total exclusion is always not possible in many cases. All referrals by the referring doctor should be considered in terms of these three questions. You know, what knowledge will I gain about my patient from this investigation? Is it going to change my management? And should it, is it really urgent? Should it be done now or can we wait? And then we come to the the last group of errors, which are very, very deceptive, incipient, but nevertheless it's very important for both the performer and the referring doctor to know. So these are the statistical errors, because due to normal variability and overlap between the normal and diseased populations, all electrodiagnostic studies will have small number of false positives and false negatives. So you can have both type 1 errors and type 2 errors in electrodiagnostic evaluation, just like any other lab tests. Generally, type 1 errors are considered to be more dangerous, in the sense that you label a person as having a disease when he or she doesn't have it, rather than type 2, in which you're likely to miss a diagnosis by doing a particular test. Overall, it is a general consensus that type 1 errors are more dangerous for the patient because it leads to wrong diagnosis when there is none, wrong treatment, and further investigation, which cost and as well as stress for the patient for being put through a lot of unnecessary investigation. So one should always know about these false positives and false negatives. So that's, like I said earlier, this is very important. EDX can never completely rule out or rule in any condition. And when the third thing to remember as far as statistics is concerned is when appropriate tests are applied for appropriate reasons, any positive result is likely to be a true positive. This again is very important to remember. For example, patient comes with nocturnal symptoms, tingling, discomfort in the hand, it wakes them up from the night, female, hypothyroid, and when you examine, you find disturbances in the median distribution, and then you subject this patient to a carpal tunnel syndrome study, and then you find the result positive. It is very likely that this is a true positive because there is a concordance between the clinical syndrome and the electrophysiological diagnosis, which is very important. When another important thing to remember here is when the electrodiagnostic lab has performed a particular electrodiagnostic investigation thoroughly after also having clinically examined the patient, and yet there is a discordance between the clinical finding and the electrophysiological study, in such a situation, mark my words, this is a caveat, when it has been done very, very thoroughly and meticulously, it is very likely that the clinical diagnosis is wrong. Always we say that the electrodiagnosis is an extension of the clinical process, but there are certain caveats to that. When the test has been performed after a good clinical examination in the lab, and when it is meticulous and directed, and it gives a particular result, it is very likely that the electrophysiology is right and the clinical examination was wrong. This is worth remembering. Therefore, it is incumbent on the person to go back and examine the patient clinically again to see if they have missed anything. Markedly abnormal tests which are done repeatedly are likely to be true positives regardless of the clinical likelihood. Again, this is something which is an extension of what I just said earlier. So therefore, what we gather from all the above is that we should be very cautious about making any diagnosis based on one single piece of data. You can't say the person has, say for example, carpal tunnel syndrome because the median distal motor latency is prolonged. You should take into account so many other factors, sensory latencies, conduction across the wrist, conduction in the ulnar and the radial nerve, getting data from other non-routine locations, like for example the thumb or the ring finger, palmar stimulation. So these things are all very important before we hang a diagnosis on a single piece of data. It is definitely worth remembering that 2.5% of all tests will be false positive based on the cutoff values, which is usually 2 to 2.5 standard deviation. This is so that we have not just 95 but 97.5% confidence interval when we perform these tests. Therefore, it is 2 to 2.5, and therefore the rest of the 2.5 will either be are likely to be false positives. Now, it is another, most of the other lab tests, if you notice, will have a lower cutoff and an upper cutoff. Whereas in electrophysiology, you will find that, for example, you take conduction velocity. There is a lower cutoff, but there is no upper cutoff. For example, no conduction velocity can be too good. You can have a lower cutoff, but there is no upper cutoff. And similarly, you know, in certain situations, you can have a lower cutoff, upper cutoff, but no lower cutoff. So in many such situations, there is only one cutoff. So you can either have false positives or false negatives, depending on these cutoffs. And this has to be interpreted accordingly. More importantly, when multiple tests are being used, the false positive rate can be reduced to acceptable levels when we combine two or more tests. And therefore, it reduces false positive if you stipulate that two or more tests should be abnormal before you make a diagnosis, which makes it more stringent. So this is very, very useful. So it is always useful to combine electrophysiological tests coherently when you are looking at a particular diagnosis so that you don't make false positive or false negative errors. But I like this best of all. You know, this particular slide is from Gutmann Seminars of Neurology. I'm just going to read it to you. It's very good. The worst pitfall that can occur in the EMG lab is going to the pressure of time. The abnormal spontaneous discharges may get buried in the patient's tremor or poor relaxation. Fasciculation potentials will not be seen because there was not a long enough pause after the insertional activity. The anomalous innervation will go unnoticed, as may the temporal dispersion. The myoclonic discharge will be brushed off as a fasciculation or a fibrillation potential. Going too fast, especially with the needle, EMG may also make the patient more uncomfortable as the movements with the needle may be unnecessarily harsher. If you go too fast, you will miss the good stuff. And that is what keeps us all doing EMG and nerve conduction studies, that is looking for the good stuff. So next we come to the report. So what do we do with the report? How do you construct the report? Now it's very important to keep it concise. It's very important to keep it lucid and to the point, and it should convey the meaning. So findings should be explained in brief to the patient if necessary. One should refrain from discussing the treatment and prognosis, etc., if the patient is referred by somebody else. If the patient is your own patient, yes, of course, you should do that. The report generated should be concise and understandable. It should preferably be typed and not scrawled. And all pertinent data should be included. Nerve conduction and NE tables should definitely be included. Summary of findings should be given at the end of these tables. The final conclusion should be clear and unambiguous. And if there are specific queries, all the queries should be answered. And if any diagnostic possibility was raised, it should either confirm or negate. For example, we should mention that there is no evidence of median neuropathy at the wrist or carpal tunnel syndrome. Or if it is there, we should confirm it saying that yes, it is there. And the reporting should be as objective as possible. The electrodiagnostic consultant should not fall into the habit of using clinical information to make a diagnosis, which is not substantiated by the study. Like I told you, for example, earlier when I said that this study is consistent with diabetic amyotrophy, no, that is not the way a report is written. You can say that there is evidence of denervation or ongoing denervation and reinnervation in specific group of muscles in a specific muscle domain or a radicular domain. You can't extend it and give a report saying that this is a case of diabetic amyotrophy, for example. So if you do that, you are straying into the clinical. If you happen to be the treating physician, you can keep your clinical notes separate and your electrodiagnostic notes separate. Limited prognostication is definitely possible in nerve injuries, depending on what you find, whether it is only demyelination, whether there is axonal process, and so on. Treatment recommendations are best left out of the EDS report. It should definitely not be included in the report which is generated. So it should contain tables and figures, the summary, all the conductions, as I told you earlier, and the conclusion should be there. It should be a precise conclusion. For example, you may say that this is suggestive of widespread motor axonal degeneration to motor root or anterior onset level. This is a single sentence, concise report. Now, as far as the referring doctor is concerned, what does he need to know? He needs only a minimal knowledge of the basic and applied physiology to understand the test results. But all electrodiagnostic reports should be written in terms that do not assume specialist knowledge. So there should not be too much of technical jargon in your report. Keep it as simple as possible and try to answer the questions which have been raised by the referring consultant, like the examples which I told you earlier. Now these are reports which I have gleaned from many sources, and this is how I would not write a report. This electrophysiological study at this point in time done on all four limbs gives evidence for right brachial plexitis. Now, this is a report which has no localizing value. It has no specific characterization. So in that sense, it doesn't give you any account of the temporal nature or the whether there is a demyelinating process or a or an axonal process. It doesn't give you anything for that matter. So this doesn't really help. The second one, this facial nerve conduction is suggestive of Bell's palsy. This is again another example of straying into the clinical, which is totally uncalled for and facetious. The current nerve conduction and EMG study gives evidence for a clear lesion involving the right radial nerve, predominantly the posterior interosseous nerve. This is obviously a contradiction in terms, and it actually confuses localization rather than helping in localization. So these are certain examples which I have actually picked up, and this is how you can easily be led astray, and you should know the principles which I told you. For all those who are really interested in knowing or learning how to write a report, there is a AEM, there is an entire guideline 2005 and 2014 on how to report, how to write a report, how to interpret a report. There is a document, you can follow it. They have set down certain protocols, you can follow them. But they have been candid enough to mention two things. You see, this is very, very important to know. Just by following those guidelines blindly, you are not likely to arrive at the correct diagnosis. That is number one. And number two, by not following the guidelines, if you have a certain protocol of your own, you are yet likely to arrive at the correct diagnosis. Therefore, it is not imperative that you should follow those guidelines blindly. They are only guidelines. They will help you in certain directions so that you don't miss out on certain parameters or you don't miss out on certain tests when you're doing them. So a few situations, if I have the time, just three or four to give you examples of how electrophysiology can help or, ditch you. 65-year-old diabetic underwent CABG. On awakening, he noticed numbness and weakness of the left hand. He was limited to the fourth and fifth fingers and hypothenar eminence. All intrinsic hand muscles were moderately weak, and so was the extensor indices properties. Now, what would one, if this patient is referred for, say, nerve condition of upper limbs, and if it is done like going to the pressure of time, routine tests, it is very likely that he may be diagnosed with an ulnar neuropathy, a non-localizing ulnar neuropathy. So what should be included? So where is the lesion? So is it ulnar nerve or proximal? So in such a situation, when you examine the patient, you find that there is not only the hypothenar eminence, but also the forearm, the medial aspect of the forearm, if there is any sensory impairment, that gives a very, very important clue. So in such a situation, one should examine or include the medial cutaneous nerve of the forearm. Definitely EMG should be done more proximally. There is a clue in the history itself. The extensor indices proprius was also weak. That's a very, very important clinical clue. So if you think that it is only the medial cord and to all the ulnar innervated muscles, you are localizing falsely distally. So therefore, if you look at only up to the medial cord level, you would be limiting yourself to the forearm flexors. If you do the other muscles, especially the extensor indices proprius on the part of the extensors, which are also from C8, you will know that you have to go even more proximally. It goes to the lower trunk. So from the lower trunk, you get fibers for the posterior cord as well as the medial cord. And therefore, this is more, it becomes more likely a trunk lesion, lower trunk lesion, rather than a non-localizing ulnar nerve lesion. So you see how easy it is. If it's a diagnosis, if a proper examination or the history is not taken just prior to performing the test. The second situation is a 75-year-old lady presented with numbness of her feet, chappal slipping off, distal weakness in wasting, absent ankle jerks. She complained of low backache as well. Symptoms have been present for about 8 to 9 months, probably slowly progressing. So the following pattern, if you consider this, like very low surals and superficial peroneals, reduced tibial and peroneal CMAPs with mildly reduced conduction velocities, peroneal and tibial F waves, a prolonged latency, small amplitude, mildly delayed edge reflexes, and denervation and re-innervation in distal leg muscles. Upper limb electrophysiology is perfectly normal. Now, what would you do? If you restrict yourself only to nerve conduction and even the distal limb muscles, you might say that this is only a polyneuropathy. Now it is well known that even in L5 radiculopathies, sometimes the superficial peroneals can be very diminished or absent. So that is that's something which is peculiar to the superficial peroneals. Whereas the surals are not affected by S1, the superficial peroneals can be affected by long-standing L5 radiculopathy. So absent or very low superficial peroneals can be misleading, and one may think of post-ganglion ablation. So therefore, in such situations, the ENT should be carried forward proximal muscles also to see definitely they do not miss out on a proximal lesion either in the plexus or in the root. The third situation, a 54-year-old woman has progressive weakness over 8 to 9 months, began as a left foot drop, followed by right within a month, no sensory symptoms or symptoms in upper limbs. However, the examination reveals moderate wasting of small muscles of the hands, especially thenar. Fasciculations are noticed in the proximal upper limb muscles, wasting, fasciculation, weakness in lower limb muscles, including proximal muscles. Spasticity with brisk reflexes is noted. Normal sensations, sphincters, mental functions, cranial nerves. Obviously, I mean, most of you would have made a diagnosis already that you are dealing with some sign of motor system disorders, probably ALS with this combination of LMN and UMN picture clinically. When you look at the report say, I'm not going to the details, we don't have time. The report, however, says the electrophysiological study shows evidence of widespread motor axonal degeneration at motor root or AHC level. Now, why do we say this? Why does the report say, this is more for the, you know, the referring doctor, why? They may be puzzled as to why we say motor root. Or sometimes they may say the electrophysiological study is consistent with active generalized disorder of the motor neuron, their axons, or both. So the question is this study consistent with the diffuse severe polyradiculopathy? The answer is electromyography per se cannot differentiate between a root, very proximal root, and anterior onset lesions based just on electromyography. So they look very similar, almost identical. So one has to depend on other features. So when all sensory nerve conductions are normal, motor nerve conductions are almost normal except for decreased CMAP amplitudes with normal conduction velocities in a situation like this, the clinical picture also is going to help you. And therefore, in such situations, we needle a lot of, there is need to perform very widespread and extensive EMG, especially thoracic paraspinal muscles, the bulbar muscles are important, because sometimes when we do paraspinal muscles, the cervical paraspinal muscles and the lumbar spinal paraspinal muscles can be misleading in such situations, because they can be affected in degenerative spine disease or radiculopathies involving these regions. So it is important to do these as well. And it is important to note that the electrophysiological report will always look like this. It is at the discretion of the examiner to say that this is consistent with the clinical diagnosis of ALS. Now, that is an extra point which may be added for the benefit of the referring doctor. But the true electrophysiological report can stop at this point. Now, this is another picture. 36-year-old man brought with acute progressive flaccid areflexive weakness of lower limbs. Paresthesia followed quickly within a matter of days by upper limbs, total duration 10 days. Again, the clinic for clinicians, the diagnosis is obvious. They're probably dealing with an acute flaccid areflexic quadriparesis, probably GPS. Now, electrophysiology was performed on day 10, and it is reported to show multifocal demyelinating sensory motor polyradicular neuropathy involving all four limbs. Now, this is again how a typical report would look like. I mean, we won't go into the details of temporal dispersion, conduction block, delayed F waves, decreased amplitudes, and what percentage of proximal versus distal. Those are all there for you people to see. There are standard references which tell you how much percentage drop, etc. should be there. We won't go into those details. What is interesting to know is that follow-up in these situations is required. In the initial stage, what this is a characteristic picture of how a demyelination will look like, multifocal, sensory motor, polyradicular neuropathy. Now, certain studies have shown that axonal GPS is pathophysiologically characterized not only by axonal degeneration, but also by what is called reversible conduction failure. So many of these axonal GPS may in the beginning be classified as a demyelinating disorder based on this. And once you keep repeating it over a period of time, say after 10 days or the third week, you will find that many of them shift to the axonal category, like AMN or AMSN, depending on what you find. So again, here, always labeling a patient in such situations as a fixed diagnosis as AIDP alone may be not so very correct. One may need follow-ups in such situations to be able to come to a more precise diagnosis. I think I'll stop here. Thanks. I just tried to give a brief idea of, you know, how taking you through the referral process, the procedure itself, how the report is generated, what kind of reports are written, and how not to write a report, and the possible pitfall both for the referring doctor as well as for the person who's doing it. I hope this was useful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vasudevan. This was exhaustive and it covered everything. We have a little time, so if you would take a few questions.
Sure.
What is the pitfall in interpretation of a conduction block?
No, like I said, one of these is the presence of, you know, misidentifying conduction failure as a conduction block. That is one thing. The other thing is obviously lab procedures themselves. Like, for example, like I told you in the one of the earliest slides I showed, so the situation prevailing in the lab, the temperature. And the other thing is not doing a proper meticulous procedure in which you are able to localize the segment in which you are able to find the block, actually. So these are certain conditions where block may actually be either missed if your entire segment in which you are testing is distal to the conduction block, both the proximal as well as the distal. Obviously, the block is going to be missed. If you are doing it proximally, then it is very likely that you will pick it up. But then it is mandatory for us to be able to identify the segment at which the block exists. For example, across the elbow in an ulnar nerve, or for example, in the peroneal nerve at the fibular head, so on. You know, if you have any other comments, I would like to know. Any other?
I think while interpretation, I don't know whether they mean while doing it or while looking at it in the report, but I think you've covered everything.
Yeah.
Question two, you only have minimal F wave latency prolonged in upper and lower limbs with a normal EMG, how do you report it?
No, that is a very, difficult situation to report, isn't it?
Depends on what he means by prolonged. No? If it's just mildly prolonged, first of all, you'll check the temperature, right?
Yes. So, yeah, that is important. And of course, the height of the person, the age of the person for whom the test is being done.
Yeah.
And as like you correctly pointed out earlier, the you know, with increasing age, there is attrition, and therefore the distal amplitude also will go down, and this will reflect in other processes as well. So now when we say mildly prolonged F latencies, now that is, it is not, in my opinion, that is not of really any localizing value. Rather, it doesn't tell you about the underlying process.
The word here is just prolonged.
Yeah.
If they are in the demyelinating range, then they suggest demyelination.
Yes, but when all of them are present, say for example, you do it, you do a cascade of 10, they are all present, and they are saying, for example, in the median now you find latency of F wave latency of say 32, 33, or 31, and so on. It also, when we say demyelination, you should be able to see whether there is more amount of jitter in the presence of the F wave, whether there are dropouts, like how you would expect in a neuromuscular examination, whether all the F waves are coming through, whether they are not coming through, some of them are absent.
Yeah.
So those things are also important when we are looking at an actual demyelinating process. And besides, when there is a pure demyelinating lesion involving only the root, likely that only this is likely to be prolonged. But again, by a process of averaging and amplification, I don't know whether the F wave is likely to be so prolonged in the demyelinating range when the entire rest of the the segment from the portion distal to the root to the tip of the end of the peripheral nerve is normal. what extent is the FA likely to be affected?
Okay.
I'm asking you for your opinion.
So there are criteria for FA prolongation to be called a demyelination, and they depend upon the amplitude of the response as well. So what we do is we follow the EFCN protocol, where they've given a kind of a correlation between FA prolongation and the amplitude. So we've made a chart, and I think for us, the lower limb values come to about 75 and the upper limb values come to about 34. But there's always a caveat in the upper limb. There should not be a median entrapment for the ulna nerve. There should not be a pressure palsy behind. So just F waves, you have to take in the clinical context.
Exactly, yeah.
I would not be too, and we calculate according to the height. So we follow Shin's. We don't have our formula as yet. So we follow Shin OJ's height-related formula for FA. He's not found an age-related change. We can do a study on that. So I think there are a lot of questions. So I think I'll just go back to your question. There's an excellent presentation, sir. Do you have any current recommendations of modified EDX study in suspected COVID patients?
No, I do not. I think that Dr. Mansukhani might be able to answer that question. Actually,
at the moment, we've just drafted guidelines for our protection.
Yeah.
And during the lockdown, we suggest to do only emergency patients because, really EMG is not a test which we require to do on a, on any kind of an urgent basis. But I think as we start doing more patients, we will be in a better. Right now, we just have to protect ourselves.
Yeah, no, that is as far as the procedure is concerned. For the person who asked that question, there is a published guideline from the Indian Academy of Neurology. It has been written by Dr. Mansukhani and Dr. Ravishankar Nayak and a few others. And you can go to the IN website. It is available there. You can download it, and it will give you all the guidelines of how to perform procedures and what precautions have to be taken while performing these routine nerve conduction and EMG procedures. That is available. But as far as findings are concerned, I am not really sure. There are a lot of reports of GBS-like presentation, myelitis-like presentation, encephalitis-like presentation, but we are still not really sure of what findings we will get when we do electrodiagnostic studies in these patients.
Yeah.
We do not have enough data.
So could you comment, if you get only a distal median motor latency prolonged, how do you report that?
Yeah, this was in fact mentioned in one of the slides. One of the slides which I had shown, I didn't go into those details because the MA motor neuron disease slide, the lady with wasting fasciculations, etc. I didn't go into the details of the values because there wasn't much time. But one of the distal motor latencies, that patient was slightly prolonged. When only that is prolonged, now there are questions which can be raised asking whether it is something like an entrapment. I would say no. Because what is usually seen in entrapment earlier is the sensory and not the motor. When you have normal motor, normal sensory findings, and only a DML which is prolonged in the median in such a situation or any other situation, is simply possibly because of drop in the number of axons, which leads to the fastest conducting fibers being lost, and therefore some decrease in the conduction velocity and the DML being prolonged in such situations. When you don't have any other finding, when that is an isolated finding, this is how I would look at it. I would not give too much importance to that. I would definitely not call it a focal or an entrapment process in the absence of other findings which would support that, like sensory findings.
Maybe two or three questions. Do you have the reference on hand, Dr. Vasudevan, for the guidelines for writing a report? Somebody wants that.
I'll have to go through that now. I've downloaded it somewhere. If I can get the email ID, I'll forward it to them.
Okay. What are the EDX pitfalls in brachial plexopathy?
Kushma would be a separate lecture by itself. Again, yeah. One of the examples that I gave was exactly that. You know, depends on both the what we examine, when we examine, and how we examine. To put it briefly, what we examine, if you don't examine, for example, let's say, let us take the same case. If a person who has a medial cord or a lower trunk lesion, if that is the clinical findings are missed, it is likely to be misdiagnosed distally as a non-localizing ulnar neuropathy. If, for example, a person has a remote lesion, an old lesion, which is partially re-innervated, which was more of a panplexus, the patient has come to us, say, for example, 2 years down the line, and only the distal ones are still showing abnormalities and the proximal ones are becoming relatively normal, there is a spurious possibility of localizing it more distally rather than proximally. So these are two examples of what I can think of right away, you know, when, who, and what.
There are orthopedic surgeons who ask the electrodiagnostician whether they should operate on a patient.
Hmm. So you are the better expert to talk to them on that. You tell us now.
No, I don't think so. Basically, I don't think the electrodiagnostician can ever make a comment on whether the patient should be operated or not, because it all depends upon the symptoms. And I think operation on the lumbar spine, in lumbar canal stenosis, depends upon the severity of the symptoms rather than the severity. Because as we know, in lumbar canal stenosis, the electrophysiology findings are usually chronic.
Yeah.
So canal stenosis operation is usually decided by the patient himself, how symptomatic it is, he is, what is his quality. As far as an acute lumbar radiculopathy, I think there are absolute indications if there is a bladder bowel involvement. If there is progressive, and mind that word progressive neurological deficit.
Precisely. So
the third one is non-relenting pain. So all these are...
Yeah. And to emphasize here, these are all again non-electrophysiological. These
exactly.
Non-clinical. Like exactly. I said in one of the earlier slides, recommendations of treatment should not be given in the electrophysiology report. So we will refrain from doing that. One other extension of what you said, a person with lumbar canal stenosis is likely to have, ongoing process. It is an on-off like thing. It is not always a constant compression. So they are likely to have intermittent stages when they are likely to recover. So it may not show a very correct picture. That is one. The other thing is post-surgery, fibrillations can persist in the lumbar paraspinal muscles for a long time, and that can be misleading. So again, that should not be taken into account when, especially post-surgically, whether, for example, a repeat procedure should be performed or whether, injection should be given. All these things should be entirely clinical between the patient and the referring doctor. And it is not it should not be based on the presence of, for example, fibrillations, lumbar, paraspinal. And another question which is asked is, again, as an extension of this, whether lumbar, paraspinal, fibrillations will help you to localize. No, it doesn't really localize to a particular segment. It will tell you a range. It will not tell you one particular segment. When you do that.